morning and welcome to Fellowship as together we celebrate this Advent season, looking ahead to the Savior's coming. Would you please rise together and let's sing the opening hymn, O Come All You Faithful. Focus on you in this time. We praise you for the sure hope, the deep peace, and the unspeakable joy that only you can give.
Heaven and earth. And remember, as Mary was on her way to see Elizabeth, Mary carrying the very Son of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. And Elizabeth speaks. She said, "For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." John the Baptist, even in the womb, at the sound of Mary's greeting, he leapt for joy. Father God, may our hearts leap for joy within us at the sound of Jesus' name, at the anticipation of his birth, at the realization that he would go all the way to the cross, that we would be forgiven of our sins, and that the most important of all relationships broken with you would be restored, that we might sing of your glory today and praise you in your glorious presence forever. Shower all of us with the power of your Spirit and with joy unspeakable. All of this we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our faithful Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as all God's people say with joy. Amen. Take a moment, turn, smile at one another, wish one another a Merry Christmas. And as you are seated again, our attention goes to the screen as our Sunday school children bring us Christmas greetings.
Welcome, Christmas friends. It's time to celebrate.
Welcome to Jordan and our way.
Welcome, moms and dads and all who came today.
Brought them baby Dana into our heart today.
Would you like to know the secret of a joyous Christmas day? Then listen very closely to what we have to say.
Put Jesus first in all your prayers, in everything you do. Remember it's his birthday time and that he died for you.
Put others second in your thoughts, your neighbors far and near. Remember those that need your help as well as friends so dear.
In your plans you must be last. If you would happy be, to please our Lord, we all must live and act unselfishly.
So now you know the secret to find joy. Christmas reigns in Jesus and in others, not in presents or in things.
There's a song in our hearts. It's a song of joy.
A sage rose up from heaven. Where's Mary's baby boy?
He lives in our hearts, him we're glad to say.
We wish you a Merry Christmas and joy for every day.
Would you thank God for the gift of his children and of our Christmas celebration? I invite Joel Barr to come forward at this time. Joel is our Vice President of Consistory, and he brings us an update again this morning on some workings within our denomination and classes.
Good morning, everyone. As we get ready for our congregational meeting today, which will be held virtually, thank you for your flexibility in that regard. Probably the biggest question we've been getting is, where are we at with the RCA? Well, in October, our church gave another update, kind of outlined what's been happening within the Zealand classes. Following the Vision 2020 report, following Synod being canceled, and getting prepared for Synod 2021. In light of the Vision 2020 report, there's a growing conversation amongst RCA churches that continuing where we are at and how we have acted for the last decade or more just is not sustainable. For fellowship, that's okay. For many years, we've been asking ourselves, do we still fit in? There's a strong movement towards having options available following Synod 2021. Towards that end, A number of elders at local congregations have started working on what's called a landing pad denomination, that depending on the results of Vision 2021, we have a place to go together. We want to continue in ministry with like-minded, evangelical, biblically-based, faithful churches. To our congregation, I say thank you for remaining faithful in a difficult year. To our staff, thank you for remaining faithful. You're leading well. Our church is an example of what other churches want to act like. Not a week goes by when I don't get a phone call or email or more asking me, what do you have going on over there at Fellowship Reformed Church? Where are you at with Vision 2021 moving forward? So based on conversations with like-minded churches, both within and outside of our Zealand classes and our regional synod, we know others are feeling and experiencing the same types of feelings that we've had, this struggle. It's okay and good to feel that way. But it remains our desire to make sure we are hurrying, but not rushing, patient yet intentional as we seek to follow God into the future. Most importantly, for fellowship, any option must be faithful to the Word of God and remain strongly rooted in our Reformed heritage. Simply without the structures that have derailed our denomination for the last 25 years. What next? I'm working with a couple elders from other churches. We are having conversations, not just within Zealand classes, not just within the regional synod, beyond. Conversations are taking place with churches in California, in New York, Pennsylvania, Minnesota, Iowa, throughout the country. They are asking us, what do you got going on in there in West Michigan? Don't do anything without us. Don't leave us hanging out there. We want to stay in ministry with you. That's a beautiful thing. God has remained faithful to us and is pointing us in a direction depending on the results of Synod 2021. What do I ask of you? Keep praying for the leaders within our denomination, within our regional synod, within the Zealand classes, and here at Fellowship. We're praying that we lead well during this time. It's not been easy. I've had a lot of late nights, a lot of early mornings, a lot of Zoom meetings with people around the country. Candidly, I'm tired. My wife has sacrificed a lot. And I'm thankful for her. And I'm thankful for you. Thank you.
Would you thank God for his faithfulness, please? No one asks to serve on consistory. The best that any faithful person can do is to simply say yes to the Lord. I'm thankful for faithful elders like Joel, for faithful deacons, for a faithful consistory that continues to do what is right and what is in alignment with the Word of God. You can do that when it's easy, but when you're doing it in a time that is challenging, it takes especially much more of you as an individual. So please continue to pray for your consistory. Today, the ballots that we have received from you will be counted as we elect two new elders and two new deacons. Please remain in prayer for these men who God has called to serve his church well. Amen, church? And here's another reason why we love the Word of God. Because it is the Word of God that shows us our need, not just for any Savior, but for the one and only Savior who is Jesus Christ. Can you believe how quickly Advent is going this year? Do you feel the same way? Yeah? Christmas is almost here. We started this season praying for the hope that is ours only in Jesus Christ. It is a hope, a prophecy, a promise that God made long ago that he would never forget his children. Last week, we lit a candle that reminds us that this hope and this peace, the peace that passes all understanding, the only one who is our peace is Jesus Christ. And that's the only way that we can have on this Sunday morning any form of joy. Our joy is not based on how well life is going. Our joy is not based on if someone gives us the exact present that we want this year. Our joy is not based on our financial standing. Our joy is found in Jesus Christ alone. And praise be to God that he tells us of that joy in the truth of his word. As we prepare to go into prayer, you see there are still there's a lot happening in the life of the church right now. I want to continue to remind you, there are those things that are published and public, and there is much happening behind the scenes in your lives and in your families. We continue to thank you for the confidence that you put into us, the confidentiality that we hold with you. But we share that there is many reasons to remain in prayer and how good it is to be able to do that together right now. Let's pray. Father God, great is your faithfulness. The promise that you made long ago and the promise that you kept, even as the angels announced and rejoiced as a choir above, all the heavenly hosts, the shepherds racing off to go and to see this thing that had happened, the birth and the arrival of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. And yet how often do we ponder and consider how Jesus left heaven? He left the glory of heaven. He left all that is perfect and beautiful of heaven. He was born into the brokenness, born into the struggle, born into the dysfunction of this world. And he knew full well why. And he knew full well where his life would go on this side of eternity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thank you for your plan. Thank you for your rescue of us. Thank you for taking hold of us through means of the shed blood of Jesus Christ and refusing to let us go. Now indeed, may that enliven within us a joy. We are not a people called to walk around with pessimistic doubt. We are not a people to walk around with faces downcast in despair. We are not a people to walk around with an Eeyore complex, believing that if anything is going to go wrong, it's going to happen to us. That's not who we are, and that is not our name in Christ. We are Christians. We are men and women who have been rescued and redeemed. That is what your word tells us. And that is what the living word, Jesus Christ, has accomplished for us. Father God, this treasure and truth of Jesus needs to be made known this season more so than ever before. Right now, in our minds, faces of people flashing in front of us, people who are not walking with Jesus, people who think they are walking with Jesus, perhaps in their words, but not in their lives, not in their surrender. They may claim him as Savior, but they are not following him as Lord. Father God, as we think of these faces, as we think of these names, as we even think about those who might be with us at a table on Christmas morning, we pray for them right now, Holy Spirit, that you will reach and impact and affect and convict every single heart, that they will know and believe Jesus as Savior and Lord, and that they will race after him joyfully with everything they have. Father God, thank you for the lives who have run faithfully after you, for Alice Beery, for little Navin Chase, who was born immediately into your arms. And thank you that you continue to cradle him safely right there. For Jane Verkuyk's sister-in-law, for the Batts family upon the passing of a brother, for the potters and for the browers who've all trusted you this week. Thank you for lives that are faithfully forever home. Father God, for so many others who are continuing to recover, for so many others who are awaiting surgery, and for Jim and Chris Zylstra this morning. For Jim, who has remained hospitalized for 20 days with COVID, you know exactly what is happening right now to his body. And you know the decisions that Chris needs to make and how she is trusting the power of your Holy Spirit to give her wisdom. She's leaning heavily into Christ for the peace that she longs for. Father God, we pray for your will to be done in Jim's life. And we thank you for the way they both trust you. Father God, thank you for the blessing of your church family here. Thank you for the generosity even today as they're bringing in meals to bless other families this Christmas season. Thank you for the way they deny themselves so that they can give much of what you have trusted them to steward. And Father, help us to use those resources well, that it's the joy of Jesus that always goes forth from this place. How? In the lives of brothers and sisters in Christ. And we will pray it always in his beautiful name, as all God's people say, amen. Miss Vicki.
Okay, boys and girls, whether you are here or at home, it is your turn. Are you ready? One, two, three. Ooh, good morning. I brought something with me today. It's a flashlight. Now, we use a flashlight when it's dark out and we want to see where we're going. So if I show the flashlight like this, is it going to show me where I'm going? No, I need to shine it out so I can see where I'm going, don't I? Because if I shine it on me, it might show other people where I am, but it won't show me how to get where I want to go. Today, Mr. Brian is going to talk about John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist, if you read about him in the Bible, he kind of looked strange. He wore strange camel hair clothing, and he ate grasshoppers, and he went around yelling and preaching and baptizing people, and he drew lots of attention to himself. But you know what he did every time he talked? He pointed all the attention out to Jesus. And he told people that Jesus was the Messiah, and Jesus was the one they wanted to go to be saved, not John the Baptist. And he was a great example for us. Because we might look and act different from other people around because we love Jesus. But if we just let the attention stay on us, no one will know about Jesus. But if we point to Jesus with everything we do, if we tell people why we're different, why we act different, it's because of Jesus. We're pointing to him. And that's what we need to do as Christians. So when you go out and people notice, why do you always have a kind word to say to people? You let them know that it's because of the love of Jesus. Let's pray together. Dear Jesus, we thank you that you sent John the Baptist first so that he could point to you and so that he could teach us how to point to you. So be with us as we go out this week and help us to point others to you as the Messiah and our only way to salvation. And all God's children said, amen.
As we continue in worship, please stand and join us in singing Offering.
Thank you.
Good to be together to worship and to open God's word. Today we're going to be continuing our Advent series, Seeking Righteousness. We've been looking at men and women who are seeking righteousness, those who have lived their lives in such a way that they would always point to the righteousness of God. We've looked at both Noah and Simeon, and this week we are going to be looking and studying at John the Baptist. So we're going to be in John 1, 6 through 8 is our main text. We're also going to be in Luke 1, and so if you kind of have a finger in there or put a bulletin in there, those are two passages we'll be looking at a lot this morning. See, my aim is that when we finish, that you, just like John the Baptist, will proclaim and recognize with your lives that Jesus is the Lamb of God. So with God's word open before us, let's pray together. Father, may what is said here this morning bring you glory. May your word, by your Spirit, so impact our lives that we live differently as a result. Convict us where we have erred. Encourage us in our obedience. As we draw near to you, Lord, draw near to us, opening our eyes and our hearts and our minds to your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. John 1, 6 through 8. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. All right, the first thing that we see is that John was sent from God. Now, a little bit ago, I was dealing with some tooth pain. I went to my dentist, and he said, I'll take a look at this, and then he froze what looked to be a Q-tip. Now, he said to me, he said, hey, tell me if you feel anything. If you haven't been to the dentist in a while and the dentist says that to you, be prepared for what happens next. All right, this frozen Q-tip was, my teeth were very sensitive to that. I about went through the roof. And as such, he determined that I needed a root canal. I had to go to a specialist. So I call up the specialist, and the specialist, they ask me in the process of this, they say, hey, who sent you to us? I said, my dentist name, and I was on my way to being pain-free. Now, however, what if I would have said something like this? God sent me to you. I've been sent to you from God. He would have said to me, like, you're crazy, Brian, or maybe they would have maybe piqued their interest a little bit, and they'd, well, tell me more. How do I know that you're sent from God? Well, how do we know that John is sent from God? Well, first, verse 6 plainly tells us there's a man sent from God, and we know that the Bible is inerrant and infallible, and therefore it must be true. So we'll go with that. But secondly, there's an angel that announces John's coming. See, John's dad was a priest by the name of Zechariah, and Zechariah was chosen to enter the temple to burn incense, which was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Zechariah was alone in the temple offering the incense when an angel appears to him and says, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John." Luke 1, verse 13. See, this is so much better than already knowing you're pregnant and hearing from the ultrasound technician the gender. I mean, no offense to any ultrasound technicians here, but this is a real-life angel declaring to Zechariah that he and his wife Elizabeth would have a baby and a boy, and they even give him the name. Like, they don't have to come up with that. Which leads us to the third proof, that John was sent from God, his miraculous birth. You see, we are told in Luke 1, verse 7, that Elizabeth was barren, meaning that she's unable to have kids, and that both her and Zechariah were advanced in years. See, they're at a stage in life in which it should be impossible to have a child, yet Elizabeth conceives and gives birth to John, just as the angel said would happen. Fourth proof, John was sent from God, will be seen throughout the rest of this message, but suffice it to say for now, the way he lived fulfilled the purpose that he was sent for. See, people who are sent, they have a purpose. I was sent from my dentist to the specialist for the purpose of a root canal. It wasn't just for fun, although they did have a massaging dental chair. That was nice. Now, you may have experienced something similar to this recently. Maybe you've had a lot of delivery vans that have come to your home. See, they are sent with a purpose, and by their very description, they are sent to deliver a package to you. They're not sent there unless you actually order something. They're sent with a purpose. John here is sent from God with a purpose. Look again at verse 7 and 8 of John chapter 1. He came as a witness, to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. See, John's purpose was to be a witness. The word witness is mentioned here three different times, twice with the words to bear in front of it. See, the Apostle John wants us to know that this isn't the passive use of the word like a fan watching a game in a soccer stadium. This is the witness that means to profess. So what is John to witness? What is he to profess about? Well, the light. Well, who is the light? Jesus. Jesus himself says so in John 8, verse 12. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world." So John's purpose was to proclaim to the world about Jesus. So the angel, Gabriel, from Luke 1, he gives us 9 details about John's purpose from Luke chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. And we're going to go through those. So if you want to flip, this would be a great time to flip to Luke chapter 1. So this is what we see very at the beginning of verse 15, describing John and his purpose for why he is being sent from God. He will be great before the Lord. Well, great is subjective to individuals. After a meal at home, specifically meatloaf, I'll say, "Babe, that was a great meatloaf." And my kids would say, "Please never make that again." This is subjective. Greatness is subjective, except for John's. John's greatness is transcendent. What do we mean by that? Jesus says of John in Matthew 11:11, "Among those born of women, there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist."
In other words, John was greater than all of the Old Testament heroes of the faith. We're talking about Moses and Abraham and David and Samson and Enoch and Elijah and Samson and so on and so on. Why? Because he was the first to point people to the Messiah, the living, breathing Messiah. Our second descriptor from Luke 1. And he must not drink wine or strong drink. See, John was not to be distracted by the pleasures of the world. He was not to be intoxicated or even be tempted by the taste of wine. His focus was to be singular, to be a witness to the light. Third, John was to be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. Pastor Sean referenced this earlier. But John is to be preaching through the Holy Spirit. It's John that will do all that he is called to do. The Holy Spirit is the one through whom it will happen. It's only through the power of the Holy Spirit that John is going to be able to witness and to do what the angel Gabriel is describing here. And angel Gabriel continues with the ministry. What is the ministry of John going to look like? Fourth thing. He will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. See, John will preach a message of repentance, turning away from disobedience and turning to the Lord. Fifth thing, and he will go before him. This is just a simple reference to the fact that John will precede the Messiah. Six, in the power, in the spirit and power of Elijah. Now, Elijah was one of God's prophets. Throughout the Old Testament, God would speak to his people, the Israelites, through prophets. Prophets would proclaim the truths of God, and they would warn of impending judgment if the Israelites were disobedient. At the time the angel shows up, Zechariah, there have been 400 years since the last prophet of God spoke. That prophet was Malachi. Now God breaks the silence by sending his angel to declare that John was going to be born. But he doesn't stop there. See, this description of John that the angel gave is strikingly similar to Malachi's prophecy in Malachi 4, 5 and 6. It says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers." See, like Elijah, John will boldly and uncompromisingly proclaim divine truth as a prophet of God. Continuing in Luke 1, John will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. See, John's message will result in conversions of entire families, and thus parents and children will be reconciled over the unity that they now have in faith in Jesus. 8, John will turn the disobedient to the wisdom of the just. John's preaching would confront cold-hearted, stubborn, unrepentant sinners and get them to seek righteousness, the righteousness of God, like he was. Finally, John would make ready for the Lord a people prepared. See, John will be the precursor, the prophetic voice who prepares the hearts of the people for the coming Messiah. Now, these are 9 things that are said already before John is even born. This is what he's sent from God for this purpose, all 9 things. But when he is born, his father, Zechariah, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, and he speaks a prophetic word over his son. And this is what he says in Luke 1, 76 and 77. "And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins." Man, what a blessing over his son that Zechariah gets to prophesy. He reiterates what the angel Gabriel said, letting us once again see that John was to be the prophet pointing people to Jesus, through whom that they would receive salvation and forgiveness of their sins. Now, don't miss that last part, as it directly ties to our main text of John 1, verse 7. It says this, "He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him." See, it is clear that John's purpose was to point people to Jesus so that they would be saved through Christ. You see, the result of obedience to the purpose given to John was salvation for other people. But when do you think John figured this out? I mean, he wasn't born when the angel spoke of him, and he was just a very newborn baby when his dad prophesied about him. Imagine John as a child. He had to have been thinking a little bit, like, man, I'm a little bit different. And specifically, maybe one day he goes up to his dad and says, hey, dad, why are you and mom so much older than all my friends' parents? And at this moment, Zechariah gets to sit down with his son and tell him everything that happened, describing all of the things. He went in to burn the incense, and in the process, the angel shows up, and it's been 400 years since a prophet of God came, and son, you're going to be that prophet. You're going to be the one who prepares the hearts of the people for the coming Messiah. Think about hearing this as a child. Those are some high expectations. If you're a teen in here this morning or hearing this, and you think your parents have high expectations for you, that's nothing compared to what John just heard. So what does he do? Well, take a look at Luke 1, verse 80. This gives us a clue as to how he responds. It says, and the child grew and became strong in spirit. And he was in the wilderness until the day of his public appearance to Israel. You see, John took to heart what was said about him. He believed it and acted upon it by secluding himself in the wilderness. This is what prophets of God would do. They would to enhance their spiritual growth and to focus their message on God. See, John needed to remove himself from the distractions of economic or political power, or even from having his message tainted by the hypocritical spiritual leaders of his time. It worked. He grew and became strong in spirit. See, even at a young age, John was fully devoted to the Lord. Kids, teens, young adults, hear me on this. You are not too young to be sold out for Jesus. The same spirit that lives in John lives in anybody who believes in Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and that includes you. In fact, it doesn't matter your age. You can be 5, 15, 37, 45, 85, and be sold out and devoted to the purpose God has for you. Don't waste your childhood, your teen years, your adult years, your retirement years, chasing after things that will not last, chasing possessions, pleasures, achievements, or worried about what other people think of you. Seek after and devote yourself to the one thing that will last, knowing Jesus and making him known. Make your life count for the glory of God. That's what concerned John the Baptist. That was his purpose. He knew what he was to do, and he was totally sold out for it. Do you know your purpose? And are you sold out for it? The Bible makes our purpose super clear. Isaiah 43, verse 7 says, everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. See, every single one of us is created by God for his glory. And we see in the New Testament in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Our purpose is to glorify God in everything that we do. Are you sold out for your purpose? John was, and he proved it with his words and his actions in three specific ways that I believe will also help us to live out into our purpose. So what are those three things that we need to do that we see from John? First, we proclaim the truth of God. Second, we humble ourselves. And third, we stay on mission. First, let's see from proclaiming the truth of God. John's ministry, by earthly standards, was very successful. People flocked to him. I mean, Matthew 3:5 tells us, then Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region about the Jordan were going out to him. What made John so popular? Why was his ministry so successful? Well, he proclaimed the truth of God by the Spirit of God. Well, what truths of God was he proclaiming? Well, Luke 3:3 tells us specifically, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. See, John was proclaiming that all are sinful. All need to confess and be baptized. I mean, this doesn't sound like a message that will draw huge crowds, does it? But it's the truth of God, and people are drawn to the truth of God's word. If you've been part of our Sword Grip Memorization Challenge, you know that John's message is reiterated by Paul in Romans 3, verse 23. He says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. See, people need to recognize by the Holy Spirit that their condition is not one of health. They are sick in need of healing. You and I on our own, we cannot get to God. We are disobedient to him, and there are consequences. John was letting the people know that it was not okay to stay in a state of sinfulness. That would only lead to death, as we are reminded in Romans 6, 23. The wages of sin is death. So, what were they to do? Well, confess their sinfulness, be baptized, and sin no more. This is why John the Baptist is called John the Baptist. He baptized people in the Jordan River as an outward sign of an inward reality, that they were repenting in their hearts, turning away from their disobedience and turning to God. But John didn't stop there. He proclaimed that they were to bear fruits in keeping with repentance in Luke 3, verse 8. And he continues in Luke 3 there to explain that that meant to share your bounty with those in need, to not cheat people out of their wages and their finances, and specifically to be content with your wages. I think three things that we could all do a little bit more of. See, John's message was clear. Stop doing what you know to be wrong according to God's word. And start doing what it says. Love your neighbor as yourselves. But there's a problem with that message still. It still falls short because people will still fall short. You see, we can't help ourselves. We will continue to sin even when we try not to. See, the best of our intentions will not compel us to perfect obedience. This is the story of nearly the whole Old Testament, from Genesis 4 all the way to Malachi 4. You see, the people, they sin, and then God sends a messenger, and they say, hey, you should repent. They repent, and things are good for a while until they sin again, and the cycle repeats. You see, the law was given that we might recognize our sinfulness and our need for a Savior. We can't get to God on our own. John was the greatest of the prophets because his message didn't stop at repentance. His message proclaimed that there was someone greater who would take away the sins of the whole world. John 1, 29 to 31 says, the next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water that he might be revealed to Israel. See, John's message in life can be summed up in this great statement. Behold, the Lamb of God. See, John introduced the world to the Savior. Now, this message of the Lamb of God would be like setting off alarms in the minds of the hearers that John was speaking to. Specifically, would be reminding them of the different stories from the Old Testament. They would surely have thought of Abraham and Isaac, where Abraham was going to sacrifice his son Isaac, but God stops him. And instead of having Isaac on the altar, there's a ram caught up in the thicket that God had provided, and he puts him on the altar in his place. They would have surely thought of the Passover lamb who was slaughtered and whose blood was spread around the doorposts of the Israelite homes while they were in captivity in Egypt. See, when the Lord came to kill the firstborn as the 10th plague, He passed over any home that had the blood of the lamb on the doorposts. The lamb was sacrificed in place of the firstborn. In hearing John declare, "Behold, the Lamb of God," they would have surely thought of Isaiah's prophecy. In Isaiah 53, 6 and 7, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth." John proclaimed the truth of God, that Jesus is the Lamb of God, the one who would save his people. And praise the Lord, John's message still rings true today. See, trusting in Jesus is the only way to be saved, the only way to experience real life, the only way to experience real hope, joy, peace, and love. Romans 3:23, which we referenced earlier, is famous for calling us out as sinners. "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." But the beautiful thing is, it continues. There's a comma there. And it continues in verse 24, "and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Have you heard John's proclamation of truth to you this morning? Do you know Jesus as the Lamb of God who has taken away your sin? Are you justified and redeemed by Christ? If not, repent and believe. Today is the day. But if so, praise the Lord and proclaim the truths of God with your words and actions. Speak of the hope that you have in Christ to your neighbors. Comment on social media posts with grace. Lovingly hold your Christian friends accountable to the truth of Scripture. Give of your resources to those in need. Provide shelter to those with none. Love as Christ has loved you. Like John, proclaim the truths of God as proof that you are all in for the purpose to glorify God. All right, that was one point. We're going to go. We got two more. But thankfully, we're going to do them together because many of the stories that they share are similar, and we'll see both of them, all right? So here we go. We are to, number two, humble ourselves, and number three, stay on mission. All right, so remember that John had a large group of people coming to hear him preach. That alone will build up a person's ego. But John did not allow pride to get in his way of his mission to point people to Jesus. See, in an exchange with the Jewish leaders in John 1, 19 through 27, John had an opportunity to take the glory for himself. The priests ask him if he is the Messiah. And he responds, speaking with truth in humility. He denies that he is the Christ. Instead of giving himself a name that would give him immediate credibility in the eyes of the Jewish leaders, he says, "I'm a fulfillment of a prophecy of Isaiah." Which leads into another question about his ability to baptize. And John responds by saying this, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." He says he isn't even worthy of being the servant of the Messiah. That's humility. It is recognizing who he is in comparison to who Jesus is. Notice that in his response, he responds with humility and gets to his mission. He points them to the one who is to come after him. Well, who is that? Jesus. John recognizes that in comparison to Jesus, he is nothing. The example of this is simple and yet profound. John is the moon. And Jesus is the sun. The light of the moon is really only a reflection of the sun. The moon in all of its beauty only gets its beauty from the sun. That's why our main text, of John 1, verse 8 says, he, John, was not the light, but he came to bear witness about the light. See, anything good in John was only a reflection of the Spirit in him. Thus, if we are to be reflecting the glory of God to men, it only makes sense that we are to be deflecting the praise of men to God. Are you trying to absorb the praise of men, claiming it as your own, or are you deflecting it back to the one who deserves the praise, and in so doing, staying on mission? That's what John does here. But it's pretty easy to say humble things, right? There's a false humility all around us. Athletes, musicians, after a performance, they'll say to one another, man, you were so much better than me out there today. In the hopes that they'll then respond, no, man, you were so much better than me. We see this on social media all the time as well. We have people who take pictures with a group of individuals, and someone will comment on there, oh, you're such a cutie, in the hopes that somebody else will respond saying, oh, no, you look so much better than I do. We have false humility all around us, and that's not John. And that's not who we are to be. How do we know John's humility isn't false? Well, take a look at what he does in John 1, 35 through 37. The next day, again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, behold, the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. See, John, he stays on a mission. He sees Jesus and says, behold, the Lamb of God. Now, behold is a great word. It's one we haven't really talked about yet, but I want to make sure you understand. It means like to turn your attention, to look intently, to notice, to take notice. You've all done this before. If you've ever been to a wedding, there's everybody who's up front. Everybody's up front except for the bride. And there's a moment in time where everybody stands and they turn their attention to the back, and it's like somebody says, behold, the bride. And everybody turns and they watch the bride walk down the aisle. This is exactly what's happening here. John is walking with his disciples, and they see Jesus, and he says, behold, the Lamb of God. And his disciples, they turn and they look, and they don't just look. What do? They follow after Jesus. They leave John. Now, what does this tell us about John? I mean, we have to speak to the humanity of this for just a moment, because John has been with these disciples. These disciples have been with John. They trust him. They know him. And so when he speaks and he says, here he is, the Lamb of God who I've been talking about all this time, you need to go with him. They go. But that's got to hurt John a little bit, right? I mean, these are his close friends. They've been with him. That's got to hurt. Yet John's mission is to point people to Jesus. And he stays the course by humbling himself before his disciples in the presence of Jesus. How are you doing? Are you willing to admit someone is greater than you are, even if that means personal loss for you? John was, but he doesn't stop there. Later, John's disciples come to him in John 3, verse 26, and they say, Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing and all are going to him. In other words, everyone is leaving you to go to Jesus. What are you going to do about this? John's response is telling of both his humility and his ability by the Spirit to stay on mission. This is what he says in 29 and 30. The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. See, amazingly, John rejoices that his followers are becoming Jesus' followers. His impact is becoming smaller, and Jesus' impact is increasing. It's humility for the glory of Jesus. Staying on mission at personal cost. See, earlier I said speaking the truths of God proved John was fulfilling the purpose of being a witness to Jesus. Well, one of those truths that he spoke got him arrested and thrown in jail. You see, he spoke out against Herod because Herod had actually married his brother's wife, and John was like, you can't do that. And obviously that's pretty reasonable, right? Well, Herod didn't think so. He didn't like being called out by a prophet of God, or pretty much anybody else for that matter. And so here we are. John is in jail. And it's during his time in jail that a doubt arose in his mind. Now, doubts aren't bad. In fact, I think doubts can actually lead to trust God more fully and deeply, given that you seek the truths in answer to those doubts. So here John is, rotting away in this terrible jail cell. He half expected to be here because he called out the king, but he could handle the torture, and he could handle the impending death if he was certain that his life mattered, that it counted, that he did what he was called to do, that he had fulfilled his purpose, that he didn't live in vain. And that's when the doubts came creeping in. Did I really point people to the right person? I mean, the Spirit descended on Jesus after I baptized him. I know that. But he isn't exactly who I thought he'd be. Is Jesus the false Messiah? Did I lead thousands in the wrong direction? Was I a false prophet? So what does he do? Well, he sends his disciples to Jesus. Now, maybe you've been in a similar situation, contemplating a situation over and over again in your head, wondering what was really true. Maybe you find yourself in a situation or circumstance you never thought you'd be in, and doubts start creeping in. Is Jesus really the Son of God? Is Christmas really a celebration of when God became man? Is this faith really plausible? Or is it just a blind faith? Does God really love me? Will he really forgive me? Is my life in vain? See, John seeks answers to his doubt by sending his disciples to Jesus, and this is beautiful. For all his doubts, he still trusts that Jesus is going to tell him the truth. You, like John, can trust Jesus in your doubts and questions and know that Jesus will not think less of you for asking. In fact, Jesus invites John's disciples to see him at work, and then he says in Matthew 11, 4 and 5, go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. John would have been set at peace with these words, seeing the evidence of Jesus that Jesus provided as fulfillments of Old Testament prophecies of Isaiah. Once the disciples leave, Jesus goes on to say that no one born of man, of woman, has ever been greater than John. And this is the man who just expressed his doubts to Jesus. This is the God that we glory in. This is the Savior that we proclaim, one who can handle our doubts, one who doesn't brush them aside, but lovingly assures us with his words and his actions. John, even in his doubts, stayed on mission by desiring to know and point others to the Messiah. He seeks the truth from Jesus. Will you follow John's example? Will you seek answers from Jesus and his word? Will you find fulfillment and purpose in glorifying Jesus by proclaiming the truths of God, by humbling yourself, and by staying on mission? I urge you this Christmas to not get distracted by decorations or presents or finances or what you'll eat or drink or wear. Jesus is what matters. And his glory is worthy of your whole life. May your life and mine proclaim, behold, the Lamb of God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let's pray. Jesus, you are worthy. Forgive us for when we try to absorb the praise that is rightly yours. Forgive us for not speaking the truth. Forgive us for when we get distracted from the mission that you've given. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our lives. You alone are worthy, Jesus. We praise you today and forevermore. And all God's children said, amen. If you would, please rise and turn your attention to the screen as our children are going to bless us this morning with our benediction from Psalm 96.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations. His marvelous works among all the peoples, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is feared above all gods.
Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the earth and the righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness.
Please join us in singing What Child Is This? 4, 5, 6.